Welcome back to my channel for my build on this single-ended KT88 amplifier. This is based on a Kegger schematic on Audio Karma, and it's very similar to the Blueglow KT88 build, but with a little twist with a 6EJ7 driver tubes and a couple of other small differences, but very similar. Probably the biggest thing is, like I said, it's got two driver tubes, and I decided to go with a slightly larger chassis than Mark used. It's a little bigger dimensionally this way, and it's also 3 inches thick. I'll put a link to it in the video text. I'm still using these little boxes that are the size of the output transformers for checking where everything's going to go. I'm expecting them to be here in another 2 to 3 weeks, but I wanted to go ahead and get starting on the fab work for the chassis. So I'm going to put these off to the side for now. And in my build, I'm going to be putting the rectifier tube between the 10 Henry choke and the power transformer to really separate the power supply away from the amplifier part of the chassis. One of the things I wanted to do was to provide some ventilation for the KT88 tubes. And if I had to do this over again, I would probably make a template for laying out these holes and do a better job of laying them out. I wasn't too concerned though, because I bought these little trim rings off of eBay that go around the tubes, that this one's, the inside diameter is large enough where there's space between the tube base and the ring so that some air can come up through the chassis to help cool the tubes. Also got some rings for the small tubes, and the nice thing about the rings for the small tubes, they have little holes that are the same distance as the as this, like that. So there's no hardware visible on the top, and the ring is what holds the tube socket from underneath that sandwiches it all together. So I thought these were pretty nifty. You know, some made in China things that I saw, I just thought they were pretty. Dress up the amp a little bit. And then I've got another one for the rectifier tube over here. Even though you really won't see it, I wanted them to match. One of the things for part of the fab work was locating the holes for this little decorative ring. And so I made a little paper template like this with the holes so that then I could transfer them to the chassis and then drill these holes so they would line up and everything would be where it's supposed to be. To punch these holes, I used some Greenlee punches that I got off eBay, and this was for the larger one, and I've got a smaller one that I use for the smaller tubes. I was lucky I found one, and here's part of the smaller one. I was lucky, and if you can find one that has this ball bearing thrust washer that goes on the top, that really makes it spin a lot smoother, and then put a little automotive wheel bearing grease on the cutter and also on these threads, and that'll help it pull through smoothly. You want it to spin as easily as possible so you don't warp the top of this. Also, a little tip I saw was to get a piece of printer paper and then, you know, like put it like that under this so it doesn't mar up the powder-coated finish on the top of your chassis. As you're pulling it through, you want to have the punch in from the bottom. Some other of fabrication tricks. One of the things that a lot of these volume controls, this is an audio note 100K volume pot. The, I don't know if you can really see, but this mounting part of the pot, not the shaft, but the part of the housing that's threaded, has flats on the side of it. And that keeps us from rotating in the hole. So you don't want to just drill a hole the size of the threaded part, because it could spin around in the hole. The way you do that is, and these are some old central vernier calipers I've had forever, you measure the narrowest part, find a drill this size, then you punch the center of it after measuring it where you want it to be, and then get something like this Dremel tool and use it to make the hole D-shaped. I did the same thing on this end of the chassis where the fuse holder goes. I have this old school, I thought this was a neat looking old school fuse holder that it's one of the kind that screws out, and it also has a D-shaped, you know, with flats on the side, not D, but a oval-shaped hole that it goes into, so it doesn't spin when you tighten it up. And I did the same thing here. The layout of this, I really wanted to keep want to keep the power supply separate. So the fuse and the switch are going to be right here at this end of the amp. And the power socket, the wire will come over from this lug to the center of the fuse holder, then from the side of the fuse holder to the switch, from the switch to the transformer, and then the neutral leg of the transformer will come back up to here. You want to wire them up in that order. You want it to go from the hot of your jack to the center of the fuse holder. And the reason you want the center of the fuse holder so that when you unscrew it, it disconnects the center first, and that this outer, this threaded part isn't hot. That the part that's hot is way down there in the center. And that's as safe as you can wire something like this up. You want the fuse first. In case the switch shorts out, it'll blow the fuse. You don't want the switch before the fuse. You want all the stuff in the hot leg. I've seen schematics where they put the switch on the neutral side, and that's really not safe, because if the transformer shorts out or something happens with it, potentially the whole chassis could be hot. And if you were standing in a damp floor or something and touched the chassis, you'd get, you know, shocked with 110 voltage. So my plan is to, you know, transformers in the back, AC wiring's here, rectifiers here. One of the things that Kegger talked about, and I will link this, the article to him talking about this build and how he wires it with the values and the wattages for the different resistors and stuff that he recommends. He also, while he didn't, I couldn't find the power supply schematic, but he talks about it. And he recommends adding another choke to the power supply. There's a 10 Henry choke, and with these two caps, there's going to be a 22 UF is going to be the first cap after the rectifier, and then there's a 250 UF that's on the other side of the choke, and these will be mounted with these straps like this to the, you know, with these two straps like this to the chassis. And I added this Hammond 1.5 Henry 500 milliamp choke that's going to be mounted somewhere like here in the front. 500 milliamp is really overkill for this amp. The power transformer is 250, and or 200, and the 10 Henry chokes 200 milliamps. The reason to go with a higher rated second choke is it keeps the resistance really low. And so you're getting the filtering, the AC filtering of the 1.5 Henry choke with very little voltage drop. I think this that choke's only got like 20 ohms of resistance or something. So it should keep the B plus about in the same place. But when I simmed it, it did, the ripple is just almost non-existent after running through this second choke. My goal with this amp is for it to be just dead silent. And to that end, it's one of the reasons that I'm routing the signal path the way I am. I know a lot of amplifiers have the RCA jacks on the back, but the way I have my stereo set up, it's easy for me to get to the sides. That's why it was okay putting the power switch on this side, and I've put the RCA jacks over here. And I plan on running the shielded cables from these jacks on the along the bottom edge, around, and it's going to go like around here and then up to the volume pot and then over to the signal tubes, and short path away from everything. I'm going to go ahead and turn this around too so I can show you the way I'm laying out the signal tubes. Is they're both going to be angled a little bit like this, and I like bending these tabs over and cutting off the ones that I'm not going to be using, just so it helps me from getting confused when I'm wiring these up. These 90 degree bent over ones are always the heater windings, and they're going to go straight down to this corner over here. I'm thinking about putting in another bulkhead across here, and one of the reasons of doing that is so that I can run these heater windings along the inside edge of that bulkhead and then up here to the transformer and keep the heater wires away from this filtering section where the B plus is getting filtered. On the tag strips, I'm probably going to get away with putting one on, I think it's going to be, it's on this side, going to have one on each side, four terminals on each side that'll deal with getting the wires to the grid stop resistors and all that kind of stuff, and then the plates will come over to the power tubes over here with the coupling capacitors. Doing the same similar thing with the KT88 tubes, they're going to be mounted like this. I've got the heater wires bent in so I can have the twisted pair come up underneath them and then split, and it'll stay twisted all the way up to the socket, and then run them down and over to the bulkhead. I'm planning on, this transformer has two sets of windings. It's got for 6.3 volts. And I'm thinking about running either the two signal tubes on one and the KT88s on the other winding, or possibly running, you know, a KT88 and a signal tube and a KT80 in a signal tube, and, you know, running them all along this front edge up the bulkhead and over to here. I haven't completely decided on how I'm going to do that. The other change in the layout from what Mark did, in other builds that use the ultralinear and triode switch, is I've seen them put them in the back of the amplifier. And I don't like the idea of any kind of wires, especially, you know, they have anything to do with the signal path going back and forth across where there may be some other wiring. And so I'm going to put the ultralinear double pole, double throw switch right here between the tubes. It's probably not something you're going to, you know, it's not something you would do with the amp in operation anyway. And, you know, you'd probably want to turn it off and have it, the voltage chill down before you're flipping the switch anyway. And so the tube shouldn't be too warm to reach in between them all and flip that switch. So that's how I'm tentatively going to be laying out the tubes and stuff. The other thing that I want to do is on the signal tubes, in the schematic, it's showing to measure the milliamp of the draw for the tube and the voltage. And on the tag strip for the signal tubes going to the cathode, I'm going to use this little jumper wire or jumper pegs that go between the tag strip to the cathode and the ground. And that way I can pull this little jumper off, and I've got test leads here, and I can make up a little two connector test lead to put on there that will go over to my Fluke meter that I can measure the milliamps on one meter, measure the voltage on another. I'm going to be using a very small potentiometer that's going to be also part of the cathode that's in parallel with another resistor along with an LED. And that way I'll be able to adjust the plate current for, there's about 10 different driver tubes that can be used with this schematic, and they all have different, you know, different current ratings with very similar plate voltages. So hopefully I can get away with doing a bunch of tube rolling and be able to just adjust the bias on those tubes, the cathode bias on the tubes, and be able to see what a bunch of different tubes sound like, which is always fun. The other thing that I've got ordered, which I'm hoping will come within the next few weeks, is from JAC Music. I ordered a milliamp meter. They've got a really neat one. It's not cheap, but it's not super expensive either. I think it was about $100, and it came with a similar little ring that goes around it to mount it with. And the reason I really liked that this meter was it doesn't go in series with the cathode ground. It goes in parallel to it, and you adjust it to your amplifier by a resistor that connects it to the cathode of the tube. And being in parallel to it, it doesn't have any effect on the signal. And if there is some kind of a problem, the voltage doesn't go through the meter. It would go through the cathode resistor. And again, I'm planning on doing some tube rolling, hopefully with this amp and the B plus that I'm going to be running. I can run KT88s or EL34s and just swap the tubes in and watch the meter and make sure that the current isn't too high for the EL34s. I'm planning on putting a two position center off switch right in front of the meter that will allow me to select one, the left or the right tube, to measure it and then put it in the center off position so that the meter's only being used when you're wanting to check how everything's running. The other thing that I'm thinking about doing that is kind of unconventional is these are the cathode resistors that I got. They're your basic, you know, 10 watt, 500 ohm resistors in an aluminum housing. And I think I'm going to mount them on the top of the chassis. And there's a couple of reasons for that. One is these things do get hot, and being underneath the chassis, they don't have as good a way of cooling. Plus, they're putting heat under the chassis where there's a bunch of electrolytic capacitors that don't like heat. The second reason for mounting them up top like this is it'll be real easy to take voltage readings and get the voltage on the cathode without having to open up or turn the amp upside down or anything. The way I'm planning on doing this is having a common ground, probably going to run a really fat, you know, like a 12 gauge solid core wire to the ground between the two of them, and drill some, you know, 10 millimeter holes where each of the three leads will come through, and which will help bring some cooling air by them as well. And again, it makes a handy place to check the cathode voltages as well as keep the resistors cool. Plus, I just think they'll look kind of cool sitting up there too. A couple of other fabrication tricks that I've learned is one of them is for deburring holes. If you get a large drill and put some masking tape on it, because these flutes are really sharp and they'll cut your fingers up pretty bad. And it works really good at just, you know, using them with your fingers and turning and deburring all the holes. The other thing I like to do is, because this is a steel chassis, is get some semi-gloss black paint and paint the insides of anywhere you drill to make sure that it doesn't rust and it just looks nicer, having especially these holes here that you could see, having the inside of them painted, then you don't see them as much either. I'm really excited about this build. I think this is going to end up being a really sweet sounding amp. Several people online have built this, you know, versions of this amp and or this specific amp, and talk about how really good it sounds. And I think that, bang for the buck, you really have a hard time beating this on something that you can build yourself and then be proud of. So anyway, hopefully my transformers will come here in the next couple of weeks and we can get busy building. Thanks for watching. Subscribe so you don't miss my next video, and hope you enjoyed it. Thanks.